Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Negotiation Handbook by Patrick J. Cleary. Narrated by Roman Howell. Introduction. This book will endeavor to walk one through the world of negotiation and dispute resolution. It was born from watching some of the highest paid professional negotiators make the same mistakes day in and day out. They were all intelligent people, but time and again, it was all too easy for them to become wrapped up in ancillary issues like ego and saving face. In the process, they lost sight of the ultimate goal. Negotiations have collapsed for every reason, from typographical errors to ill-timed news stories and shareholder meetings, and even one negotiator forgetting to tell a joke. Discussed in Chapter 4. This book is written for negotiators, but the observations come from the mediator's vantage point. As a mediator, one has the ability to peek at both sides' cards, as it were. As a result, it is easier to see from the end result whether each side maximized and minimized its gain in the negotiation. In almost every case, one party, or both parties, failed to gain everything they could have gained from negotiation because they lost sight of the prize somewhere along the way. Some of the vignettes herein will seem silly or specious, yet they are all authentic, drawn from actual disputes. The scenarios are not intended to demean the anonymous subjects or make them look small. Quite the opposite. Their jobs are difficult, and they were earnest and bright. Yet even the most seasoned negotiators fall into common traps over and over again. Hopefully, through this book, the reader might peer inside the minds and hearts of those who have gone before, who tried mightily, but who repeatedly failed. I was mediating a case between a very large company and its largest union in the last week before the strike deadline. They were only a few days away from the end date, and only four issues remained: pay, retirement, healthcare, and duration, i.e., the term of the agreement. We were totally bogged down, and despite everyone's best efforts, no paper, no ideas had been exchanged in a day or more. Time was running short. The union came to me very worried and said, "Look, we're really stalled here. Somebody's got to make a move and get things going. We're running out of time." I put the monkey on their back. "Will you make the first move?" We had been talking for the last day or more about the healthcare issue and about possible solutions. The company had made a bold proposal which the union viewed dimly, and the parties were left far apart on the issue. Basically, as the current healthcare system was structured, there were no employee contributions to the premiums, and the company wanted to change that. A huge emotional and economic issue of the day. The union thought for a while and finally came back to me to review the other issues. On retirement, they were still pretty far apart. On wages, they were a little closer, but that issue wouldn't fall until last. Why? Because it always goes last. It just does. I learned that it was one rule that wasn't worth bucking. That left duration. In the company proposal, the contract was up for negotiations 4 months after the last raise became effective. The union proposed that the contract not expire until 12 months after the last raise. A mere 8 months were all that separated them. Ironically, the last raise was only a 1% raise, so the company probably could have taken the union position outright anyway, because they could bet they would wind up paying more than a 1% increase in the first 8 months of the next agreement. But in any event, they had their position, and by God, they were sticking with it. The union thus hatched a plan. They said to me, The smallest issue left on the list by far is duration. The other three issues are huge. We are poised to make a major move on the healthcare issue. If the company gives us what we're seeking on duration, we'll come back and propose basically the same healthcare package the company proposed a few days ago. But we can't make the first move. To trade such a small issue like duration for an enormous issue like healthcare was a significant move on the union's part, to say the least. I quickly called in the lead negotiator for the company and sat him down with the union's chief negotiator. It was just the three of us in the room. The company negotiator was a seasoned veteran. He had negotiated contracts for large employee groups in several different industries. By all accounts, he was at the top of his game, the peak of his career, the number three executive in this mammoth company. The union representative spoke first and laid out in a very matter-of-fact tone the terms of their deal on the two issues. "We'll give you your healthcare proposal," he said, "if you can give us the 12 months on duration." The company rep paused for a few moments, then spoke. "I'll give you 8 months on duration." I couldn't believe my ears. Obviously, neither could the union rep, because he just lost his temper and stormed out of the room. The company rep followed him out the door and started back toward his room. I ran after him. "Are you crazy?" I asked him. He seemed as puzzled as I was.
"What do you mean?"
"I mean, they are about to give you the healthcare issue exactly the way you want it, in return for a measly 12 months on duration. Only 8 months more than you proposed."
"I can't do that," he said. "Just accept the proposal exactly like they laid it out."
"Why not?"
"I'll look weak."
He thought that by just accepting the deal that the union laid out for him, without cleverly jiggling the numbers, kicking the tires a little, that he would just look, although he were caving in. He was right, caving in to probably the best deal I had ever witnessed. I was incredulous.
"You'll look like a hero," I answered.
We stood in the hallway arguing for several moments. All the while, I was aware that the union rep was on his way back to tell his committee they were going home to prepare for the strike, that the game was over. I told the company rep that he was crazy not to take it, that he was being ridiculous. He finally relented, but under great protest. He told me I was the one exercising bad judgment and that I was making a huge mistake, but that he'd reluctantly agree to the 12 months duration. I raced back to the phone and reached the union rep precisely at the moment he was walking back into his caucus room. I told him that he had his 12 months duration and that I expected him to keep his end of the deal, which he did. These parties ultimately closed the deal on money and retirement a few days later. But I can attest to the fact that this one episode left wounds on the union side of the table that never quite healed. They felt they had gone the extra mile to get the talks jump-started after a period of dormancy, and with the end closing in on everyone. In return, they felt as if they had been slapped in the face, and it was only reluctantly that they were willing to put that deal together, much less the rest of the agreement. Because this one negotiator decided to be tough, he almost lost the entire ball game. He was so bogged down in his position and in posturing that he damn near lost the war. As you can see from the vignette, even the best, most seasoned negotiators make some very stupid mistakes. From the outside looking in, it's very easy to see. It is not so obvious, however, when you are standing in the arena. Some of this book is in the context of dispute resolution rather than negotiations. A negotiation, in its purest terms, is a dispute, after all, no matter how benign. It involves two or more parties with a difference of opinion about the details of the deal at the outset. Necessarily, then, the book will move back and forth between rules of negotiation and of dispute resolution, but they are interchangeable. Only the vantage point changes. Negotiation views disagreement from one side of the table. Dispute resolution views the dispute from the middle or from above. In short, there is nothing new under the dispute resolution sun. All disputes share common pathologies, from the earliest differences between Cain and Abel, to a rent dispute, to the Middle East, to the last high-profile strike. This book will also endeavor to demystify the negotiation process as well. In everyday life, whether we realize it or not, we negotiate all the time, with spouses, children, co-workers, neighbors, and vendors. The process of demystification here is akin to a prenatal class, bracing the unwitting new parents for what is to come. Lawyers spend their lives in the courtroom, but that scene is intimidating to the layperson. Boxers spend their lives in the ring, a terrifying forum to the non-pugilists among us. For those who do not negotiate professionally, a difference of opinion about terms or the shape of a deal in any context can be intimidating and fraught with peril. The aim of this book is to describe those elements common to any dispute, any negotiation, and to impart some basic tenets to guide you. One observation at the outset. Many excellent books written on negotiation endeavor to bring the reader to a higher plane, to more enlightened thought, to a zen-like world where everybody wins. These are ideal goals, and the reader should be encouraged to strive for perfection in all things. However, experience shows that most of us inhabit a very different world, a more practical one, where there is some degree of zero-sum negotiations, i.e., if you win, they lose. If you can achieve the higher consciousness, put away this book and never look back. Go in peace. However, if you can't seem to get there because the noise is too great or because your negotiating partner has you on the run, clutch this book to your chest and refer to it often. It will help you to hold on and to steer through the storm, to keep your eye on the prize. Some have described negotiation as a continuum from empathy to assertiveness. If you can live at the far empathy end of the scale, all will go well. However, especially in the labor management setting, negotiations are an exercise in assertiveness. In these settings, it is often hard to keep your wits about you. Many of the lessons in this book will either help you move the negotiation, the dispute, toward the empathy end of the scale, or help you deal more effectively when you find yourself on the assertiveness side. To prepare oneself for the life of a negotiator, there are really only two appropriate disciplines: early childhood development and education, and nuclear physics. Concerning the former, people can become so immature and insistent on getting their way that they become childlike. As Robert Fulghum's famous book suggests, everything you need to know, you learned in kindergarten. The pettiness and the petulance can really be quite palpable and damaging to the process. For a mediator, it is akin to driving from New York to Orlando with 2 5-year-olds in the back seat. When they're not asking, "Are we there yet?" they're fighting. Mediating takes great patience, firmness, and a healthy sense of humor. In the shadow of LaGuardia Airport, I spent most of one winter with a particularly belligerent union and a particularly intransigent company. We varied our meeting locations as I tried in vain to find the right feng shui, the spirits that might enable us to get a deal. One day, we met in the union's headquarters. It was a small office with a small conference room where we huddled. Although it was blustery cold outside, The conference room was like a furnace. Incidentally, a hot room is typically a mediator's ally, in that it provides a good external motivation for the parties to reach a deal and leave. But this day, it was not to be. At the appointed time, the parties convened in the conference room. The company lawyer walked in wearing an Air Force parka and sat down. He, too, was a seasoned negotiator and a very capable lawyer. The union representatives came in and joined him, and we began. The parties had a long history, and they simply didn't like one another. It didn't take long before a heated discussion on the first issue erupted. The company negotiator had not even had time to take off his coat. He became so enraged at the union negotiator that he stood up and announced loudly, "That's it! I'm leaving!" "Sit down," I said calmly. "You're not going anywhere." To make matters worse for him, I was sitting between him and the door in this cramped room. He would leave only if I moved, and I didn't plan on moving. We had a brief but tense standoff. Finally, he took his seat again, exasperated. "Fine," he said. "I'll stay," he exhaled loudly. "But I'm not taking my coat off," he added dramatically. I looked at him half in amusement, half in bewilderment. "Okay," I said. The poor guy sat there for an eternity, wearing his heavy winter coat in this sweltering room. It took all the self-restraint I could muster not to burst into laughter every time I looked at him, perspiring under that big coat. All I could see was a kid in man's clothing. As for the nuclear physics, the analogy is this. Recall your first class on the atom. Recall that before it can move up a band, the atom must gain energy. And before it can move down a band, it must lose energy. So too with negotiations. When parties change their positions, compromise, move down a band, if you will, or accumulate a series of moves downward, the move is very commonly accompanied by some discharge of energy. Labor negotiations can get quite loud. In more polite company, negotiations can take different forms. One party may become irritable. They may suspend the negotiations, walk out. They might lose their temper. But one way or another, the energy must be discharged in order for the move to be made. Not to worry, it's part of the process. Discussed further in the section, Noise is Part of the Process, Chapter 5. I was involved in a negotiation between a mid-sized company and its union. On an annual payroll of under $1 million, the parties were still a few million dollars apart over the life of the proposed 3-year agreement. After a recess, the company presented the union with a proposal that made nearly imperceptible movements in the direction of the union position. The union took the proposal and went off to review it, presumably to respond later in the day. However, only a few hours later, the union called me to say they were ready to respond, and I called the parties together. The looks on the faces of the union committee were grim. The tension in the room was palpable. It was clear that they were not pleased with the company's infinitesimal, barely token move. The chief negotiator for the union spoke. Until this day, she had been fairly void of emotion. But at this moment, she was vitriolic. "We are shocked and insulted by the company's proposal of earlier today," she began. The adjectives and epithets then came in a torrent. "Outraged! Disgusted! A slap in the face to all your employees!" When she finished, she threw across the table 4 or 5 copies of their counterproposal. She reviewed it briefly and stormed out of the room with the rest of her committee. I remained seated in the room for a moment longer to review the proposal on my own, and to gauge the company's response. Incredibly, the company and I were reaching the same conclusion as we read it. The union had trimmed almost $1 million off their last proposal. After the company had made probably the smallest move in the history of all negotiation, the union responded, after a tirade of course, with a $1 million move. I took the lead negotiator for the company aside. He was a courtly southern gentleman with an easy manner and a distinct drawl. "Well," I asked, betraying no reaction, "what do you think?"
"What do I think?"
he deadpanned as he scanned the proposal again.
"I think if we piss him off real good again, we just might have ourselves a deal."
I had to laugh at the thought, but he was right. In this particular case, the union needed to make a significant move, and they knew it. But they had to give off the energy equal to a nuclear blast before they could do it. The truth is, like so many other disciplines, one can best learn negotiation by doing it, by observing it, by studying it. The goal of this book is to illustrate some common traps and to impart some do's and don'ts along the way. You might chuckle at the profound stupidity illustrated in some of the vignettes, but you should also see a bit of yourself therein as well. There but for the grace of God. One final observation on the nomenclature used throughout the book. You'll note the use of the word counterpart or partner to refer to the person or persons with whom you're negotiating. This will be the only concession to New Age thinking in this otherwise zero-sum book. You'll hear more about this later, but the point is to not waste time and energy. Don't borrow excess baggage by thinking of your counterpart as your adversary or your enemy. But for the accident of birth, you might be sitting where they sit. Presumably, they have the same goal you do. That is, to negotiate a solution, or in negotiation parlance, to get a deal. You're in this together. They are your adversary only to the extent that they disagree with you on some details, on the shape of the deal. In the larger sense, the bigger picture, they're your counterpart, your partner. It will take both sides to get the deal. Don't lose sight of that along the way.
Chapter 1. The Dynamics of Negotiation. More than anything else, yes, even more than money, the negotiation process is about power, ego, leverage, saving face, and of course, being right above all else. Power. At the core, every negotiation is a power struggle, no matter how small. It is one side's attempt at primacy over the other side's point of view or position, and no one ever wants to feel powerless. Even police hostage negotiators know as a first tactic to create the illusion of power or control in the mind of the hostage taker. If he or she feels powerless, the situation could erupt. The same is true in even more calm surroundings. I was involved in a case between two warring professional associations. One side was Group A, an association of very highly paid professionals. On the other was Group B, an association of state civil servant bureaucrats who regulated this particular profession. The average compensation of the professionals was several multiples of the average pay of the state workers. Group B could not seem to find consensus on a uniform set of regulations, so Group A faced a patchwork quilt of rules, which they found totally unacceptable. They were trying to force Group B to reach that consensus, but to no avail. While Group A felt a sense of urgency, Group B appeared to be taking their own sweet time. Group A was totally agitated and called me for advice. Before we met, Group A had issued a list of demands to Group B, which they were reinforcing through near daily public statements. In between whacks with this stick, they would employ the carrot and try to ply select members of Group B's leadership with gifts and resort vacations. Money was clearly no object. For their next move, Group A told me they were preparing a massive public relations campaign directed at Group B, a full frontal assault to get them off the dime. First, I said, I'd stop issuing demands. I cited the well-known adage that it makes no sense to holler at a pig. It only frustrates you, and it annoys the pig. In all aspects of life, Group B was subjugated to Group A. At every meeting, at every intersection, they were reminded of their inferiority to Group A. Time and again, they were quite literally left in the dust of Group A's limousines. In short, Group B felt almost powerless. Almost. Group B had only one bit of power, of leverage, and that was that they set the rules that Group A lived by. Group A could spend, scream, pound the table or their chests as much as they wanted. Group B would work on a uniform set of rules when they were damn good and ready. The angrier Group A grew, the happier Group B became. Power. Having it for a change felt good. Once they issued the uniform rules, they would never have it again. In the labor management setting, labor is used to taking orders from management. During negotiations, they are on a more equal footing, however, and can make demands of management that they can't make in the ordinary course of business. During negotiations, labor can hold up the sale of a company unit, or delay a merger, or cause a slide in the stock price if they decide to rock the boat. For the rest of the year, and in fact once the deal is done, they can feel quite powerless. As a result, there can often be random exercises of power by those in a negotiation who aren't used to having it and who may not ever have it again. Like a teenager behind the wheel of a Porsche, they find the novelty both thrilling and dangerous. Leverage. Leverage goes hand in hand with power. When you have power, you have leverage. Leverage, however, can be more temporal and fleeting. It often moves back and forth in the course of a negotiation and can change from issue to issue. In a labor negotiation, there's typically a balance of leverage overall. In fact, in most negotiations, there is a balance of leverage. But if, for example, you're in an affluent area trying to buy a luxury car that is in short supply, you'll discover what it feels like to have no leverage at all. Leverage is a wonderful thing when you have it, and it's pretty rotten when you don't. In most people's lives, there are only a few times when they actually have leverage. It's inebriating. Like our friends in Group B above, they had leverage for the moment, and by God, they were going to use it to the fullest extent possible. For the world's best example of leverage, we have to step outside the world of labor negotiations and turn instead to the world of Uncle Bernie. Uncle Bernie is one of my many uncles. He is this wonderfully ethnic, great, good guy. All his life, he had pretty mediocre luck, which is to say he had pretty rotten luck, but no matter. After retirement, he hit the mother lode of leverage, thereby changing his luck forever. Uncle Bernie lives in northern New Jersey, and like many of his neighbors, dreamed of escaping New Jersey someday. And so, many years ago, he drove off several hours into the hills of Pennsylvania. Uncle Bernie bought himself a nice parcel of land. That is, he put down about $100 on a nice parcel of land and signed a loan for the rest. Back he went to New Jersey, where he continued to live and work for more than another decade. Each month, he very dutifully wrote his check to the lender and crept ever closer to owning the land free and clear. Yet, he never visited the lot itself. He left it out there like a dream that he only thought about. He wouldn't go back, he vowed, until he owned it and was ready to build his retirement home. Like all good Irishmen, he was a little superstitious and didn't want to jinx his dream home. Soon, retirement was nigh, and so it was time for Uncle Bernie to make the trek to view the lot, meet with the builder, and decide on the plans for the house. En route, anticipation was high. It had been so long since he had been there. He even wondered whether he could still find the neighborhood. Find it he did. As he drew closer, he could see that it was no longer the desolate outpost that he had visited more than a decade ago. Indeed, the area had built up as the builder had promised. Finally, Uncle Bernie pulled up in front of his lot. There it was, after all these years. Right there where he had left it, just as he remembered it from the day he bought it. Except that someone had built a house on it. That's right, somebody actually built a house on Uncle Bernie's lot. Somebody had made a major mistake. In fact, more than one person had to make a major mistake for something like this to happen. Among those in the deepest trouble would be a few lawyers, a title company or two, probably a bank, a builder, and some other bit players. At that moment, as Uncle Bernie stood there, mouth agape, looking at his lot and somebody else's house, he became awash in leverage. I know of no other example in history where anyone ever had more leverage than Uncle Bernie at that moment. As you might imagine, Uncle Bernie pretty much had anything he wanted from the builder. He built a beautiful house on a much better lot, and it really didn't cost him all that much, and he never even filed suit. Leverage. It's great when you have it. It's awful when you don't. Ego. Ego also drives many negotiations and lies at the heart of many disputes. Negotiators of all shapes and sizes and levels of sophistication have enormous amounts of ego invested in their proposals, their view of beauty. It is, after all, my proposal, my language that I wrote, my organization, my building, my house. Also, people like winning, however they might define it. To lose is a blow to the ego, and no one wants that. Negotiations grow more difficult the more the negotiators are wed to their proposals, to their way of seeing the world. In any negotiation, the person with the smallest or the largest ego wins. In other words, those who are comfortable enough checking all that baggage at the door will ultimately prevail. Why? Because they will be able to see through the haze of ego to the merits of the various proposals, regardless of where they originated. Sometimes in negotiations, one side makes demands of the other as a sort of love test, to try to exercise some leverage. They might insist, for example, that they meet only at a location that they choose. The egoists among us would bristle and insist on meeting at a place of their choosing. The best negotiators don't care where they meet or whose proposal is discussed. Their interest is in getting a deal, and they do. Saving face. Also tied up in ego and power and leverage is the concept of saving face. No one wants to be taken advantage of. At the end of the day, both parties must be able to save face. The more high profile the dispute, the harder this is, which is one reason why mediators attempt to institute media blackouts in very public cases. Former Labor Secretary John Dunlop, a fine mediator in his own right, says that the greatest decisions are made when no more than two people are in a room. Even mediators must sometimes clear out and let the parties talk directly to one another because they've been busy posturing for the mediator as well. They need to save face even with the mediator. As a negotiator, it is very easy to become caught up in your own point of view, and to grow increasingly averse to the point of view of your counterpart. This is natural. You are an advocate, after all. In difficult or prolonged negotiations where personalities clash, it is easy for each negotiator to want unconditional surrender from the other. However, the best negotiators understand that it is their job to make sure their counterpart saves face. You need to give your counterpart a back door, a way out, a way to claim even partial victory. If you do, it makes it easier to reach a deal on your terms, which presumably is your goal. There is a type of face-saving in every labor management negotiation. Once a deal is reached, the handful of union negotiators must take the tentative agreement to the full membership for ratification or approval. Typically, the union crows about its big victory over management, while management remains silent. One reason for management's silence is to assure some degree of face-saving for the union, and it is wise for management to do so. If after every deal management publicly boasted that they had carried the day, the union members might believe them, reject the contract, and send their bargainers back to the table to extract more concessions from the company. By showing some restraint, the company allows the union to save face and secures a final agreement, hopefully one containing some terms favorable to the company as well. One final thought on saving face. At the end of the day, the tonic effect of getting a deal is great. Think back to the most high-profile disputes you can think of. Do you remember what the issues were and who prevailed on each? Neither does anyone else. Think of some of the most public major league sports negotiations and strikes. On the day they end, there is a story about who gained from the agreement and who lost. After that story, the agreement is never mentioned again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.